Well, good morning. Because not that many in the room yet, so y'all got to really make up for the ones that aren't here. Good morning. That's much better, much better. Thanks so much. We are glad you're here, whether you're joining us online or whether you're here physically in the room. Love to know how we can help you, how we can get information to you if you need it, connect you to things. You can fill out that card there in the pew. You can scan the little QR code on from anybody wearing one of these tags. Or if you're online, just send us a note through that means, and we would love to help you however we can. Just a few things to know about, 40 Days to Life campaign. Please check into that, sign up for that. We still have some spots available. The candy drive for the Fall Fest, there's a brochure outside. You can grab that for Fall Fest. But the candy drive going on until October 29th. Next Sunday, very important, next Sunday is our Celebration of Grace Sunday at 9:30 here in this room. We'll be gathering together to celebrate some of what God is doing in helping us learn to speak grace. There is a card, I think it's in the bulletin again today. I actually forgot to look before it came up here, but I think it's in the bulletin. If not, they're outside. It is. Okay, grab that card, fill that card out, and be prepared to come and express your support, your encouragement, and your commitment to speak grace to those who need it, those maybe who we've had conflicts with over time, or those who just need a word of encouragement. There is a Discover First a Van class coming up November 6th. And, you know, sometimes we hear a name and we can't put a face with that name. We know they're around, and our directory online is lacking a lot of your beautiful faces. And so October 30th, and then for four Sundays, we are going to have the opportunity for you to come and let us take your picture so that we can update that. That'll be, I think, over in the fellowship hall. So if you'll just come over there, we would love to get that picture and get that taken care of. Now, in a little while, most of you heard this week that Pastor Jim was hospitalized. He had what appears now to have been just a really, really virulent virus. They're not really sure completely all that was going on, but he's much, much better. And so much, just wants to thank you for your prayers and for just, he felt those, knew those were there, and that was very encouraging to him. Today, we'll be hearing from Dr. John Main. John is a member of First of Van. He grew up on the west side of Detroit. He was a happy guy yesterday with the Wolverines game. But he spent 44 years in pastoral ministry. And, you know, God has just blessed us with a lot of folks in this church who have a lot of ministry experience. But John spent 44 years in pastoral ministry. He was an associate pastor at Bible Church of Little Rock, and then 20 years at the Bible Church of Cabot, then 22 years in Indiana. So just a wealth of ministry experience that we're thrilled to have in our midst. College at Bryan College, then both his master's and doctorate from Dallas Theological Seminary. But he says his most important accomplishment in life is that he has been married to Clarice for 48 years. He said anything beyond that is just superfluous. Doesn't make any difference. They moved about 2 years ago here to Memphis to help be involved in the lives and help with the raising of their youngest grandchildren. And they've been here at First of Van since 2021. And so we will welcome John to the pulpit here in just a little while. Now, I want to invite some of our members to come and talk about one of the ministries with which we partner here in town.
Good morning. I am Stephanie Moore, and I work with Steve and Yo on the Memphis Ministries team. And we are super excited because we have a new local, very close to First of Van ministry partner. And I have a couple of people joining me this morning because we already have volunteers here at First of Van working with this particular ministry. And we have the opportunity as a church to work in very close proximity to our church. So I have Betty Baird and Allison Riggs here to share a little bit this morning. Allison, tell us what the ministry is and what it's all about.
The ministry's name is Arise to Read, which goes into local public schools at the invitation of the principal to work with second grade students to help get them onto reading level. The statistics have shown that 89% of children that do not read on grade level by the end of fourth grade will end up incarcerated or on government assistance of some kind. But those students that are reading when they get to third grade on a third grade reading level that come from poverty, will 89% of those will graduate from high school.
Great, thank you. Betty, you've been involved for a while, so tell us how long you've been involved with Arise to Read and what that experience has been for you.
I believe this is my fifth year, and I do 1 hour a week, two children, half an hour each, and it's so simple and enriching, and I just love them. The minute you walk into school, you know God is at work, because you see their faces, they're so happy to see you, and you know the results, because when we start out, they take, it's like 16% ready for the next grade, and by the end of the year, it's like, it goes up to like about 67%. So that is so fulfilling, and I love being there to glorify God, and I hope that they see that in what we do.
Tell us what it's like when you get there. Do you have to be a school teacher?
No.
To be able to
No. 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 Anybody who can read, and I can read and write, although some people don't believe that, but it's true.
Thank you. Allison, how long have you been involved? And tell us just a little bit more about Right to Read.
I just got involved last year, and honestly, it made me a little bit nervous. I have taught three of my children to read before they started school, and the other two do read as well. They were just taught at school. But I found it very intimidating to go in and teach that to children in someone else's program. And when I got there, I was amazed at how simple, it is a simple program. It is laid out, truly anyone can do it. As Stephanie said, you do not have to be a teacher. The joy just in the kids that come in, that you get to interact with as you walk through it with them, they just want to talk to somebody. They want to tell you about their life. So you have some opportunity while you're teaching them and working through the program just to learn about them and show interest in them, which some of these children probably don't have that like my children do. And so that is a really sweet thing to be part of. This year, Ridgeway Balmoral Elementary School, which is just 9 minutes from church, already has the Arise to Read program set up, but also wants to do a backyard Bible school on Wednesdays. Well, I think
you're right. It's 3:30 to 4:30, yeah. They basically, if the principals invite the program in, that's how programs get into the school. And some of the schools have an after school Bible club. And again, it's just at the invitation of the principal, and this principal specifically asked for an after school Bible club. And this is where we have the most need right now to get involved with the ministry. There is still need for reading tutors, but in order for this Bible club to start, we have to say, yes, we have volunteers. So you may have noticed the little QR code up there on the screen, and I'll just go ahead and tell you, if you don't know how to do this, all you have to do is open your camera on your phone and point it up there at that thing, and it'll pop up and you can get to a site. And this is a way for you to share with us your contact information. That does not commit you to being a volunteer. This is simply a way to get more information. And so we need volunteers to help with the Bible club. We need people to volunteer to provide snacks, provide materials for the Bible club, also materials for the students that are in the reading and tutoring program. So again, submitting your name and email address with this QR code doesn't commit you to anything, but it will allow us to give you some information. We do have a training next week set up for anyone who's interested in helping with the Bible Club. It also will be an informational meeting if you're interested in just finding out more or finding out more about the tutoring program. We have several other volunteers here at First of Ann already working with Arise to Read. Christine Hanna is going to be a champion for our church with Arise to Read, and Molly Summers, Mary Miner, and I know I'm probably forgetting some others, but Cindy Granger. Yes, Cindy Granger. She was so excited. She volunteered to do it twice a week instead of just once a week this year. So anyway, we would love to have you involved, and we would love to share more. We're really excited about the proximity. Less than 10 minutes from the church means that we have the opportunity to invite these children and their families to participate with us here at First of Ann. So we see this as a unique opportunity among our local ministry partners. Thank you.
It's good to be together as God's people to worship Him. Let's stand together. We're going to read together from Psalm 95, calling one another to lift our voices and to bow our knees before the King. He is a great God. Oh, come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation.
Let us come into His presence with thanksgiving. Let us make a joyful noise to Him.
For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods. In His hands are the depths of the earth. The heights of the mountains are His also. The sea is His, for He made it, and His hands formed the dry land.
O come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker. For He is our God, and we are the people of His pasture, and the sheep of His hands.
We join God's people throughout the earth, throughout the ages, even now praising Him in heaven, lifting our voices in melody and praise to the Lord.
Hey! This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You lay down your life, that I
thank you. King, and bless your name forever and ever. Every day I will bless you and praise your name forever and ever.
Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised, and his greatness is unsearchable.
The Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love.
The Lord is good to all, and his mercy is over all that he has made.
All your works shall give thanks to you, O Lord, and all your saints shall bless you. They shall speak of the glory of your kingdom and tell of your power, to make known to the children of man your mighty deeds and the glorious splendor of your kingdom.
Your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and your dominion endures throughout all generations.
Amen. Let's take our seats.
Oh,
Let's stand together and lift our voices.
I will glory in my Redeemer, whose priceless blood has ransomed me. Mine was the sin that drove the bitterness and hung him on that judgment tree. I will glory in my Redeemer, who crushed the power of sin and death. My only Savior before the holy judge, the Lamb who is my righteousness, the Lamb who is my righteousness. I will glory in my Redeemer. My life he bought, my love he owns. I have no longings for another. I'm satisfied.
Let us pray together today. We will glory in our Redeemer, who carries us on eagle's wings. He crowns our lives with loving kindness, his triumph song we will ever sing. We will glory in our Redeemer, who waits for us at gates of gold, and when he calls us, it will be paradise. His face forever to behold, his face forever to behold. Lord, you say in your word, one generation shall commend your works to another, and we shall declare your mighty acts. On the glorious splendor of your majesty and on your wondrous works, we will meditate. One generation shall speak of the might of your awesome deeds, and we will declare your righteousness. We shall pour forth the fame of your abundant goodness and shall sing aloud of your righteousness. Today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. Lord, we're about to hear the the prophet's lament. How long shall we cry for help? How long shall we see violence, iniquity, injustice? How long do we have to endure? How long till justice is vindicated and death is finally put away? Bless John as he brings this message today. May we open our hearts to your Spirit. We praise you that we have this sure hope. You showed John, the prophet, John Zebedee, a vision. We trust that the many sweet saints from among us who have recently left the flesh behind, we know that they have been given white robes and you have invited them to rest just a little longer. We know that illness and pain and suffering also afflict us daily a little longer. Give healing, relief, and comfort to Jim, Marcy, Jason, and Mike. Thank you that we can pray and know you hear and are at work. We know that we are surrounded in this age by trouble and evil, yet your gospel goes out. Your good news is being spread by David and Meg Robbins through their leadership of Family Life Ministries. You are saving and healing people and marriages and families, though Satan and culture is attacking you and your designs for us. Continue to restrain the work of the evil one. We thank you that so many have responded to the work of your Spirit, your word, your work on the cross and in their hearts. May you enliven and empower us, this church, to endure a little longer and share the gospel faithfully. We thank you and ask you that you bless the work that you have called for the kingdom to do in our community. May they give you the glory. Open our hearts and hands to share with those trapped in generational poverty, as these ladies explained this morning, and brokenness from abundance. And may we share from the abundance of grace and the abundance of goods that you have provided to us. God, the Lord, is our strength. He makes our feet like deer's feet. He makes us tread on high places. Amen.
Kids, you are dismissed to go to your class.
Good morning, First Evan. I'm sorry for the circumstance that puts me before you this morning. Jim Fleming has been a marvelous gift to the church, and I pray for his return. Our desire is to have him back next week to preach. He had a sermon entitled Oops. And I wasn't sure if that was because he wasn't feeling well or if he had some vision that I might be taking his place. But this morning, it's my intent to leave all the oops to him. And we'll look forward to his return. I know enough not to teach Daniel this morning. That would be a big oops. I am going to get close. And that wasn't necessarily planned. I didn't realize that until this morning. I was thinking, oh, I hope Jim wasn't going to take a side road to Habakkuk. I also knew better than to look at something controversial. I thought I'd leave that to the paid staff. My wife encouraged me to be encouraging. She's always doing that. I need to be. An hour after Taylor informed me I'd be preaching, I got a call that I needed a text and a sermon title and an outline. It was due in about an hour. So, yes, I'm doing something I very rarely have done in my life, and that is I'm doing a sermon I've done before. So, ready or not, here we go. This week, Clarice and I were at Fall Creek Falls State Park with three couples with whom we attended college 50 years ago. In preparation for that trip, Clary suggested I look at Psalm 90 for a devotional, and verse 10 caught my attention. The years of your life are 70, or even by reason of strength, 80. And I think we have a couple people celebrating that today. Yet their span is but toil and trouble. They're soon gone and we fly away. Their span is but toil and trouble. That is the days of our lives. In reality, if you are a people, and I perceive that several of you here are here, you're not a stranger to pain, disappointment, trouble, toil, or sorrow in your life. Or if you're not familiar with those, get ready to meet their acquaintance. God's ways are not our ways, is a phrase Christians often use. Sometimes we say it out of comfort. Sometimes we say it out of confusion. Sometimes we say it because this whole world in general and our little part of it in particular is such a mess that we have a hard time understanding how our mess jives with God and his presence in our lives. Habakkuk is one of who freely expresses his concerns, his frustrations, his doubts to God. As he does, he gets a message loud and clear that God's ways are not our ways. God is an entirely different means of working than we do. And if we're going to take him seriously, one of the things we've got to get straight is the fact that God approaches our problems in a manner much different than we would do if we were in charge, which we're not. I trust that by now you have used your table of contents and found Habakkuk in your Bible. The book begins with a burden, which is another word for an oracle. The prophet's burden. The burden is a heavy weight that rests on the shoulders of a prophet. In this case, it's Habakkuk. Habakkuk is unique among the prophets in that he doesn't write a message to people. Well, it does for us, but he wasn't writing to people. It's more of a dialogue between the prophet and God. It's like a journal where he writes his complaint and then records God's answer. It's a book that begins with sobs, but it ends with a song. And so we find him in chapter 1 sighing loudly. So loud, we can hear him today. Habakkuk was ministering to the southern tribe of Judah about the time Daniel was taken into captivity, which is 605. And in verses 2 through 4 of chapter 1, we have a picture of life in Judah at the time. We read, "O Lord, how long shall I cry for help and you not hear? Or cry to you violence, and you will not save? Why do you make me see iniquity, and why do you idly look at wrong? Destruction and violence are before me, strife and contention arise. So the law is paralyzed, and justice never goes forth. For the wicked surround the righteous, so justice goes forth perverted. Here is a man who is disturbed about his nation. He sees everything going wrong. The people are living in wickedness. There's unrest and violence, injustice and oppression throughout the land. Those who have the responsibility to correct things do nothing about it. When the whole matter is brought before the courts themselves are corrupt. Sound familiar? Notice the words. How long? Why? Those are questions we invariably ask God, and he most often never answers. Why, Habakkuk says, does he have to cry out violence and hear no answer? In Jeremiah 22:17, Jehoiakim is a king of Judah, and he's described this way: but you have eyes and heart only for your dishonest gain, for shedding innocent blood, and for practicing oppression and violence. Not a good legacy for a king. As we listen to the news, we may have similar international as well as national concerns, and yet those things can easily be drowned out if we're experiencing some personal crisis that brings overwhelming pain to our lives. You're not thinking of national and international issues if your family's in turmoil, if your health is in jeopardy, or your livelihood is threatened. What is happening elsewhere is not of immediate concern. But finding stability in an unstable world is a challenge we all face, no matter what our life circumstances. And the tragedy, as far as Habakkuk was concerned, was that in all the tumult, in all the chaos, and all the things that seemed to be going wrong, God didn't seem to be working. He didn't seem to be waking up. Perhaps we too are sometimes tempted to think that way, to think that God is not caring about the struggles of our own individual lives. Now, Habakkuk is a man of God, and he knows that the thing to do with a problem is to take it to the Lord. And he's been doing that. He's been praying about his problem, but he does not get an answer. So in bewilderment, he cries out, "Lord, how long do I have to keep this up? This crying out to you like this. You do nothing about it. I've been watching for a change, watching for an outbreak of revival, watching for something to happen, yet nothing happens. How long must I continue?" God never tells Habakkuk why, and God never answers how long. Habakkuk looks at his world and says, "This nation reeks. And if you are the holy God of heaven, how can you stand back and let this condition continue? Lord, step in. Help us out. I'm watching it go down the tubes. I'm wondering where you are. Do you even care a little bit?" Perhaps you felt that way a day or two. You've prayed and prayed and prayed and prayed, and nothing happens. The silence of heaven can be deafening. Every one of us is named Habakkuk, and we share and is being perplexed. But God answers Habakkuk in verses 5 through 11. He says, "Look among the nations and see. Wonder and be astounded. For I am doing a work in your days that you would not believe if told. For behold, I'm raising up the Chaldeans, that bitter and hasty nation who march through the breadth of the earth to seize dwellings not their own. They are dreaded and fearsome. Their justice and dignity go forth from themselves. Their horses are swifter than leopards, more fierce than the evening wolves. Their horsemen press proudly on. Their horsemen come from afar. They fly like an eagle, swift to devour. They all come to for violence, all their faces forward. They gather captives like sand. At kings they scoff, and at rulers they laugh. They laugh at every fortress, for they pile up earth and take it. Then they sweep by like wind and go on, guilty men whose own might is their God." In other words, God says, "I've been answering your prayer, Habakkuk. You accuse me of silence, but I haven't been silent. You just do not know how to recognize my answer, because my ways are not your ways." Habakkuk is saying, "Give me your game plan." God says, "You wouldn't believe it if I told you." Habakkuk says, "Tell me." God says, "I'm raising up the Chaldeans." Habakkuk says, "I can't believe it." So there's a little nation that's beginning to rise in world history. These people are bitter, hostile, ruthless, and cold-blooded. And God says to the prophet, "I'm behind this. They're going to be powerful as any nation on earth has ever been. And they will sweep through lands, conquering everything. And it will look as though nothing can stop them. These people will not have any God at the center of their life. Their own might is their God, and they trust in their own strength. And I'm behind the rise of this people. And this is the answer to your prayer." Now that is astounding, isn't it? Habakkuk did not know what to make of this, if he thought he had a problem when he started. He is even more perplexed now. And this is what bothers many people. People look at what is happening and what has happened in the world, and they're perplexed as to why God allows things to happen the way they do. Why does he permit such terrible events to occur in human history? How can a just and loving God allow this? And that is where Habakkuk is. He was puzzled by this strange silence. And when he heard how God was moving, he could not understand that either. But then he does a very wise thing. And the next section of this book is a most important passage, because it tells us how to handle this kind of problem. What do you do when you're confronted with this kind of threat to your faith? Notice what the prophet does in verses 12 and 13. He says, "Are you not from everlasting, O Lord, my God, my Holy One? We shall not die. O Lord, you have ordained them as a judgment, and you, O Rock, have established them for a reproof. You who are of purer eyes than to see evil and cannot look at wrong, why do you idly look at traitors and remain silent when the wicked swallows up the man more righteous than he? What is he doing? He's thinking about God, not based on his own imagination about what God should be like, but he's thinking about God as God has revealed himself previously to Israel, and Habakkuk starts thinking about his character and about his words. Wait a minute, Habakkuk says. Are you not from everlasting? Lord, aren't you going to come to our rescue? We are your people. You've made everlasting promises to us. We can't be wiped out. Aren't you going to deal with this situation? Look how bad it is. Now, come on, prove your character. Well, God had told Habakkuk, all right, this is what I'm going to do. And Habakkuk responded, good night, God, the Chaldeans. You appointed them to correct us. God, we are wicked, but they are more wicked than we are. How can you be holy and bring the Chaldeans to judge us? How can you use something more wicked to clean up something that is less wicked? And of course, you know, when he's talking about the Chaldean, he's talking about the people in Babylon that took Daniel that we've been studying about. By the way, do you know the answer to those questions about how God can use wicked people who are more wicked to clean up something that is less wicked? Do you know the answer to that question? All I know is that God's ways are not my ways. It's all I know. So here's Habakkuk, totally confused because he's not God. He's uncertain. He doesn't know what to say. He doesn't know how to pray. So we come to chapter 2 and verse 1, which is a pivot in the book. It says, I will take my stand at my watchpost and station myself on the tower and look out to see what he will say to me and what I will answer concerning my complaint. Habakkuk stands at his guard post. He's apparently persuaded there's something crosswired in his head, and he needs reproof from God, and he's going to wait for God to speak. So in chapter 2, we see Habakkuk sitting tight. We are seldom more effective in all of our lives than when we make a determinative effort to sit and wait on God. Stop the complaining. Stop the wrestling. Stop the inner churning. In verse 2, we see that God answers Habakkuk. The word translated answer in verse 2 conveys the idea of being favorable, docile, amenable in one's response. In other words, God smiled when he answered. Oh, Habakkuk, I'm glad you stopped and listened. I'm glad you waited. That pleases me. Now I'm ready to answer you. And God said a number of things that Habakkuk needed to hear. He knew all about the Chaldeans, and he spells out their sure doom, which we'll get to in Daniel 5. And he knows your enemy. He knows the frustration you are under. He knows why. He knows how long. He knows what it is going to do in your life, and he knows the depth to which it will go before it will go away. God says, okay, now that you've stopped talking, start writing. Verse 2 reads in chapter 2, the Lord answered me, write the vision, make it plain on tablets so he may run who reads it. In other words, Habakkuk, I'm going to tell you the answer. Now I want you to write it down. I want you to write it so plainly that anyone who reads it will be able immediately to tell the answer abroad. Spread it over the land. Then God adds these significant words in verse 3. For still the vision awaits its appointed time. It hastens to the end. It will not lie. If it seems slow, wait for it. It will surely come. It will not delay. God is saying, I have a plan, Habakkuk. If this isn't going to happen right away, there's going to be a lapse in time, but it will come. Such is the character of God's revelation. First, God says an event will happen. Then he says, don't you worry about what happens in between. Even though it looks like everything is going wrong, what I've said will happen. It's going to happen. And if it seems to delay, wait for it. It will come. You live by faith, not fear. Then God goes on to state that principle that is quoted three times in the New Testament and forms a basis for perhaps the greatest movement that God has ever had. He says these words in verse 4. Behold, his soul is puffed up, referring to Chaldeans. It is not upright within him. But the righteous shall live by his faith. These words are quoted in New Testament, Romans, Galatians, and Hebrews. These are the words that lit the fire in the heart of Martin Luther, quoted by Paul in Romans. The righteous shall live by faith, not by circumstances, not by reasoning or by human effort, but by his faith in what God has said. God says they are proud. Their souls are not right within them. But in contrast to them, the righteous will live by their faith or faithfulness. If you live by feelings, Habakkuk, you'll continue to be curled up in a corner, quaking with fear. But you live by faith. You listen to me. You trust me. You speak for me. You write my message. You live by faith. Those are your marching orders. And those are your marching orders, First Evan. There are marching orders for all Christians to enter into the living of every moment of our lives in all that we do by faith. We, the justified ones, those declared righteous before God, possessing an alien righteousness. We are called by God to live lives of faith, to live faithfully before him, lives rooted and resting in what God has revealed. Throughout the rest of the chapter, there's a very interesting analysis of the Chaldeans, what God plans to do with them. To summarize, God says to the prophet, now Habakkuk, don't you worry about the Chaldeans. It is true that I have purer eyes than to behold evil, and it's also true that I'm raising up this people to judge the nation of Israel. But in turn, I will judge the Chaldeans. Daniel chapter 5. The very thing in which they trust will prove to be their downfall. Their very gods will overthrow them. And after describing the Chaldeans in verse 5, he says that There are woes they must face. Notice verse 6, 9, 12, 15, 19. All have these woes. When God writes woe over nation, it is finished. God promises the ultimate condemnation of the people of Chaldea. They are living on borrowed time. Well, Habakkuk's circumstances is not a bit different. But he's listened to God and he's changed. The last words of the book say, "For the choir director on my Gibson guitar." Habakkuk has composed a psalm, a song that is highly emotional, poetic form. It's a grand piece, the hallelujah chorus of the day. So in chapter 3, we find him singing out a most remarkable prayer. Notice how he begins. "O Lord, I have heard the report of you and your work. O Lord, do I fear? In the midst of your years, revive it. In the midst of the years, make it known. In wrath, remember mercy." Habakkuk began this book by saying, "Lord, why don't you do something?" Now he says, "Lord, be careful. Don't do too much. In wrath, remember mercy. I see you're working, Lord, but remember in the midst of it that you're still a God of mercy." This prayer is one of the most remarkably beautiful poetic passages in all of Scripture. In it, the prophet goes back and remembers what God has done in the past. That is what convinces Habakkuk that God can be trusted. He rests upon events that have already occurred, events which cannot be questioned or taken away or shaken in any way. And this is where faith must rest. We do not live by blind faith. We live with a God who has acted in time and space and has indelibly recorded his workings and his will in the progress of human events. This is the kind of God we have, the God who actually moves in human history to accomplish events that no man can duplicate. As the prophet thinks of all this, his mind goes out to the greatness of God, and this is the way he concludes. Verse 16, chapter 3. "I hear, and my body trembles. My lips quiver at the sound. Rottenness enters into my bones. My legs tremble beneath me. Yet I will quietly wait for the day of trouble to come upon people who invade us." Habakkuk asked God to show him his might in verse 2. He didn't realize what he was asking for. Now he knows what God is going to do. He sees what is coming. Evidently, the vision was quite a display. His heart pounded. His lips quivered. He felt about to collapse as his bones were in the state of decay. He was trembling. The fearsomeness grips him. He senses a terror. But Habakkuk's confidence and hope are renewed. He said he would wait patiently for the day of calamity upon Chaldea to come to the nation's oppressors. That's Daniel 5. Notice how he concludes in verses 17 through 19. "Though the fig tree should not blossom, nor fruit be on the vines, the produce of the oil fail, and the fields yield no food, the flock be cut off from the fold, and there be no herd in the stalls, Yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will take joy in the God of my salvation. God the Lord is my strength. He makes my feet like the deer's. He makes me tread on my high places. What is he saying? He's saying that though the circumstances may seem desperate, nothing to drink, nothing to eat, nothing in his bank accounts, no flock, no cattle, yet he declares that the Lord is his strength. He will exalt in the Lord and rejoice in the God of his salvation. His interaction with God, reflection upon God and his revelation has changed him. Gone is the inner churning and wrestling and anxious striving over the approaching Chaldeans, replaced by the awe of the awesomeness of God, creating a steadfast confidence and reliance upon his God. He has been reminded of the God he serves. His sighing has been transformed into a song. Have you discovered that though the problem remains and the pressure is still there, there can be a strengthening of the inner person that makes the heart rejoice and be glad even in the midst of difficulty because of who God is? That is what Habakkuk discovered. The Lord himself, he says, is my strength. It is not his circumstances that give him confidence, but his God. Have you discovered, like Habakkuk, that though you have nothing else, with God alone there is hope, with God alone there is salvation? And if you haven't, but know that you're desperate for hope, that you need God in your life, a God who's sufficient for your deepest needs. After the service, see a cross over to your right in the back, and someone will be there to talk to you about the glorious good news of hope that God is available to you through his Son, Jesus Christ. Let me very quickly leave you with five lasting life lessons from this little book, and I will be very quick with them. Number one, God can handle all of our questions, but he will answer only a few. He answers all we need. Number two, God's purposes are greater than our problems. We are part of something much larger than ourselves. Number three, waiting strengthens our patience and deepens our perspective. The short view is usually the false view of life. First impressions are often wrong impressions. Initial impressions of God's working are usually incorrect ones. So in waiting, we have our perspective deepened and our patience is strengthened. Number four, the bottom line of faith is not silence of all of our doubts, but to make us rest in the certainty of God. Habakkuk didn't understand everything. He never knew why or how long, but he rested trusting in God. So number five, trust in God gives us stability in the midst of an unstable world. It is how we live right when everything seems wrong. So as we live this week, let us keep our attention on God, for his ways are not our ways. Right thinking about God leads to right kind of living. a life of unshakable trust in the God through seemingly unstable times. And that gives us something to sing about all the days of our lives. Let us pray. Father in heaven, may we live by faith before you. May we trust our lives and the challenges you bring to each one of us into your hands as you carry out your plans and purposes to accomplish your sovereign will. May we exalt in you and rejoice in you, for you are our strength, the God of our salvation. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
We're going to close this morning with a hymn written by William Cowper. William Cowper lived a couple hundred years ago, had all kinds of tragedy in his life, struggled with depression, but he wrote hymns out of the midst of that that declared his trust in the Lord. The last verse that we sing together comes here from Habakkuk, saying that though vine or fig tree neither bear fruit, yet we will rejoice in the Lord. Let's stand together. We haven't sung this hymn before, but we'll sing it to a familiar tune.
Sometimes a light surprises the Christian while he sings. It is the Lord who rises with healing in his wings. When comforts are declining, he grants the soul again a season of clear shine. Thank you.
singing 1 Peter 3:14 and 4:14 together with the goal of memorizing it. So I thought maybe we would try to say it together. Okay? This might go well, this might go terribly, okay? But we're going to try to say it and then we're going to sing it, okay? It starts with "but even if," okay?
But even if you should suffer for the sake of righteousness, you are blessed. And do not fear their intimidation, and do not be troubled.
Okay, we're doing all right. Okay, let's do it again.
But even if you should suffer for the sake of righteousness, you are blessed. And do not fear their intimidation, and do not be troubled. If you are reviled for the sake of Christ, you are blessed. Because the Spirit of glory and of God rests on you. Here we go.
Like prayer, there will be folks in the back corner who would love to be able to pray with you, talk with you. Go now in the grace of God who will sustain you.